I think it's time, drumroll, to introduce our keynote speaker, Marco Slatt. So, awesome.
Hey, everyone.
Hi, Marco.
Hey, Marco. Hey. Nice to see you.
Good to see you, too. Excited to be here. It was a great session last night, so I'm really looking forward to today as well.
I think today's speakers, including you, can definitely follow it up with a good session.
So for those of you who don't know Marco Slatt, he is the lead architect on the Citus open source database project at Microsoft. He started working at Microsoft over 4 years ago as part of the Citus data acquisition. So he actually was working on Citus and Postgres from, I don't know. Well, you're going to probably cover that in your talk, your whole background. So I don't want to steal your thunder, but I just wanted to explain your expertise. And then I think we should just let you take it away. You've got your PhD in distributed systems from Trinity College Dublin. So I think you know what you're talking about. And let's just dive in.
All right. Sounds good. All right. Yeah, I've actually been working on Citus distributed Postgres for 9 years now, which shockingly, I recently realized it's 25% of my life. But it's actually because it's still such an interesting problem. Like and what I want to do today is kind of talk you through some of the core underlying challenges of distributed Postgres and some of the things we've done inside us to try to solve them. Look, when we put up my slides, thanks. So you're probably familiar with Citus as a project because it's the namesake of this conference, but basically it's a distributed Postgres implementation that's built as an extension on top of Postgres. So it gives you the ability to distribute and replicate Postgres tables across a cluster of PostgreSQL servers. And then you can connect to any of the nodes and you'll see that same set of tables. Under the covers, they will be sharded across all the nodes. So you can, and queries that you do on the distributed tables will be routed or parallelized across the cluster. And it's open source. You can get it from GitHub. There's packages, Docker images, source code, whatever, however you want to consume it. And you can also get a managed cluster using the Azure Cosmos DB for Postgres service. Now, why is something like Citus needed? Why do we want distributed Postgres? Well, it's pretty simple. So Postgres is great. You know, it's robust, it's versatile, it's efficient, it's extensible. People love it. It gets used more and more. It's still one of the fastest growing databases, but sometimes it gets used a little bit too much, and then you run into various scalability problems. And you kind of always have to sort of think in terms of the realities of today, the hardware realities of today. Nowadays, most software, including databases, is deployed to cloud hardware, meaning virtual machines in data centers. And virtual machines are very convenient. You can get as many as you want, whenever you want, for as long as you want. But they are typically capped at a certain size, let's say 64 cores, if not virtual cores, then physical cores. Maybe half a terabyte or a terabyte of memory, and that's about it, because it's just not economical to have much larger virtual machines than that. And then the storage is nearly always a network-attached disk that's replicated over the network, and that's nice in terms of availability and durability and resizing and snapshots and encryption, but the downside is that it incurs some latency and it limits your storage bandwidth in terms of IOPS. And then there's the software realities that nowadays a lot of transactional applications, like in the past, you may have had transactional applications that were tied to something going on in the physical world, like a hospital administration or an airline booking system. But there's only so many planes, only so many patients. But nowadays, you can have these applications that are almost like unbounded in terms of their growth, at least as long as there's more people in the world, such as software as a service applications that can quickly grow in the number of tenants, or IoT applications that can have more and more devices sending more and more observations, social applications with more and more interactions. So this kind of data intensity from these applications can overwhelm Postgres on typical modern hardware. And what that looks like is, for example, if your traffic grows, you get more and more CPU usage, you use more of your storage bandwidth. If a greater section of your data is frequently read, so it's like your working set, then what happens is more data will be have to be read directly from disk rather than from cache. And that means you use more of that limited storage bandwidth. And your data grows. Now, data grows, often you can think of it, okay, I just need a bigger disk. But what happens in a lot of Postgres workloads is that they're not very trivial. There's a mixture of operations. And maybe there's a very small number of kind of batch operations or analytical queries. And as your data grows from, let's say, a gigabyte to 10 terabytes, those operations start taking so much more resources that it kind of starts dominating your whole workload. So that's also a very common scalability problem that you have to factor in. And then there's Postgres-specific problems that have to do a little bit more with the implementation of Postgres that, you know, there's one write-ahead log all the sessions try to kind of get their bytes into. And it's a bit sensitive to storage latency, especially when the storage device is saturated. You get, well, maybe not excessive, but you get quite a lot of memory usage due to the process-based architecture. If there's a lot of update and deletes, you can get table bloats. There's going to be a great talk about that later as well. And in essence, the promise of distributed Postgres is that you get to run away from these problems by scaling out. So as you these applications grow along some multiplier, you can add more capacity such that you don't quite hit those scalability issues on any individual node, and you don't have to deal with them, and your customers don't feel the pain of things getting very slow. But no one has come in and just submitted a patch to Postgres and say, oh, let's make it distributed. So why is this such a hard problem? And this is a tricky, complex question, which doesn't have like one easy answer. So there's many different facets, and I'll only discuss a few. But I want to discuss some of the problems that, to me, are very core to building a distributed Postgres database. And they're not often always talked about. One is the data locality problem. And to me, this is the combination of having network latency between our machines in this cloud data center where the cloud maybe tries to put our machines close together, but there's not always capacity. So we end up with a few hundred microseconds up to a millisecond of latency in between the machines, which wouldn't be so bad. But we also have in Postgres workloads relationships. Relational databases are very much relational. The rows are joined together. They are grouped together. They are in a transaction together. They're in foreign key relationships. And then also transactions depend on each other, like queries depend on updates, updates to the same row, inserts match the where clause of an update or not. So there's all these kind of explicit and implicit relationships in the data model, in the workload. And for the database to deal with those relationships, to evaluate them, it needs to know both sides of the relationship effectively. So basically the CPU needs to kind of pull both sides into itself and then do some computation. And so this could look like we're doing a join between one set of rows and rows in one table and another table. So we're walking through rows on one side, and for every row on the left, we need to do like an index walk to find the row on the right. And every index page requires memory access, sometimes disk access. So it adds a little bit of time. Memory is very fast, you know, like 100 nanoseconds or microseconds. Disk can be a lot slower because of the network, but overall, this is still a pretty quick operation. Now, what happens if we take our relational data model and we try to spread it across machines? Everything gets extremely slow. And so this is, in some sense, a part of the essence of the distributed Postgres problem, that the baseline is for everything to get slow when you spread it across multiple machines. Because now, let's say your index is laid out over the network, your CPU has to fetch every index page. It takes a millisecond. And so maybe the whole operation joining two rows takes like 10 milliseconds, and then the whole query takes 100 milliseconds. Now, it's not necessarily bad for things to take a little bit longer. You can still scale even if things take a little bit longer. But the problem is we're dealing with Postgres. And the Postgres protocol is synchronous and interactive. I send a query, and then I wait for the response, and then I send the next query. I don't tell the database like what my whole transaction is going to be. And what that means is that the maximum throughput you can get on a single connection is essentially 1 over the response time. And the total throughput is the number of connections divided by the response time, no matter how much hardware you have. Normally, your expectation is that, okay, my machine is overloaded, my response time goes up, and that's why I'm seeing lower throughput. But in the case of a distributed database, actually, response times might go up just by adding more hardware. So your throughput might go down. The other problem is that many client libraries, such as object relational mappers, they're not very efficient. They don't expect to have high latency. So they send long transaction block, set some settings, send some save points, then do the same query several times for no reason. And so very quickly, your 10 millisecond query becomes a 100 millisecond transaction, or a 100 millisecond query becomes a 1 second transaction. And then if you have 1 second transactions, and you still want to get super high throughput, let's say 1 million transactions per second, you need 1 million connections. And that's really not very practical from the application point of view, even if your database was able to handle it. So to actually get good scalability characteristics for a distributed Postgres database, we need most of the operations to be not distributed, like to be local to a particular machine. And then one of the nice things about having a distributed database, for example, is that we can ensure that there's always enough memory to keep our working set in memory, and therefore can avoid disk access. So it can actually be much faster, and we have the capacity to scale to any size. And to do this, you basically want that there aren't too many relationships across the different machines in your cluster. And that implies that you have certain workload patterns and certain ways of modeling your data. And so the way we've addressed this problem in Citus is by giving you two very important primitives. They're not groundbreaking or unique to Citus, but they are nonetheless extremely important. And first is collocation. So you can distribute two tables by a common dimension, such as device ID in an IoT app, and then collocate collocate them together. And that way, the same set of devices across these different tables will always be on the same node. And therefore, joins on the device ID, foreign keys, and other relationships along that dimension can all be evaluated locally on that node. Similarly, you can create reference tables, which are replicated everywhere, and then joins and foreign keys and other operations on any column with the reference table will be local to each node as well. And then the Citus query planner, if it sees that a query just goes, can be fully handled by one node because of the way the data is organized, it can just take that query and forward it essentially to that node. And one of the nice things there is because we're building this on top of Postgres, Postgres is very good at just dealing with answering a query on a set of local tables. It can, you know, use its indexes, it can use statistics, it can use its query optimizer. So we don't lose any of the efficiency we had compared to Postgres. This also works for inserts and updates and stored procedures and other operations. And also, even if it's a query doesn't go to a specific node, if we're joining on the shard key or joining with reference tables, we can still delegate the entire join and complex subqueries to each node and parallelize and then aggregate the results. If you have non-collocated joins, performance inevitably is going to be worse, because then you do have to make, then Citus does have to make all the network round trips. But this gives you the opportunity to model your data in such a way that it's you essentially avoid the distributed Postgres problem, the data locality problem. And what this means in practice is that, and these are some benchmarks that GigaOM released comparing different distributed Postgres implementations. And for reference, I added a HammerDB result from a very large Postgres server. And in the Citus case, in the Cosmos DB case, because we take kind of data locality into account, because we lean on the efficiency of Postgres, we can be much faster than Postgres. But if you don't, you might be much slower than Postgres. So this is really the difference between having performance at scale or just being distributed. So it's, again, one of the most important distributed Postgres problems. But it does also imply that you now have a new problem, which is the distributed data modeling problem. So you have to find a way to map your workloads into these distributed data modeling primitives. And a common technique is just essentially do what the NoSQL databases do, is you distribute tables by primary key. And that's still quite good for microservices, for example, that just use a single table, maybe with a JSON column, and that can scale well for high throughput CRUD workloads. But if you have a more complex application, let's say a software as a service application with different dimension, a to-do list, context, emails, labels, filters, you kind of have a lot of tables. But typically, the application is always doing a query in the context of a single tenant. So what you can do is then distribute and collocate those tables by the tenant ID and kind of get the nice scalability characteristics. And in IoT applications, it's often nice to distribute by the device ID and parallelize the queries. Another example, and there's different examples. Another example is geospatial apps often have some kind of map data structure that they can then make a reference table. And this is a table that contains like polygons of like, this is the shape of the Netherlands, and this is the shape of Germany. And then your point data, your observations, your traces can be a distributed table. And then you can join that with the map. And that will be a local operation on each node. So effectively, distributed Postgres works well for a set of workload patterns. And the ones we most often talk about for Citus are multi-tenant OLTP, high throughput CRUD workloads, and real-time analytics dashboards with IoT and time series data. And you know, these, you know, even if you have a CRUD workload, you can still have, you know, SQL query and distributed transactions, but the essence of your workload should probably fit some one of these patterns. The one nice thing, because Citus is an extension to Postgres, we don't change how Postgres work. If you don't distribute your tables, it does nothing, which means you can actually still have just regular Postgres tables and just distribute some of your tables and make some tables reference tables. That way you can have this hybrid between a regular Postgres database and a distributed Postgres database and handle much more complex data models where your like dense relationships are kind of compacted into a single node, but then some very large table is spread across multiple nodes. So another problem that just won't go away is the versatility problem. The Postgres manual is huge. There's just so many features, different types of indexes and planning features and table spaces and full text search and geospatial. Like there's really an endless list of features. And the way to deal with this is for a distributed database builder is to just go at them one at a time, make distributed implementations one at a time, and where possible, find opportunities to take advantage of being a distributed database. For example, insert select command in Citus are really fast. Like if you insert into a distributed table, select from another distributed table, there's all sorts of ways in which that can be parallelized, even if it's not a collocated operation. So those are then things you can take advantage of if you have a large Citus cluster. And there's also still lots of gaps. We're working on things like schema level sharding. There's still gaps around snapshot isolation and geo partitioning. And these are things we'll hope to resolve in the future, but it just takes a very long time to build a distributed Postgres database. And finally, and this one is a bit more controversial, but I've noticed over time that distributed databases exist at the intersection of two very different engineering disciplines, distributed systems and databases. And they have different focus areas and different things they care about most. And me as a distributed systems engineer, I'm very focused on trade-offs and like how within the constraints set by things like network latency, can I still provide something useful for a particular workload? Should I sacrifice some functionality to get there or some other workload's performance to get there? Whereas database engineers tend to focus on much more generic solution and focus on just CPU efficiency and storage efficiency and correctness. And of course, both of these things are extremely important. Not one is not more important to the other when you're building a distributed database. They're just sometimes a little bit hard to combine. But what we found is that with being an extension, the core database engineering is effectively encapsulated in the Postgres project. And Microsoft contributes a lot to the project. I think now we're the fourth biggest contributor. And then Citus kind of wraps around that as an extension and is more focused on the distributed system side and making trade-offs that favor particular workloads that we see among Microsoft customers. So we found this to be a nice way to kind of keep the efficiency and the progress of the Postgres project, but while also building an advanced distributed database. So thank you very much for listening. So some of the key takeaways are distributed Postgres helps you run away from scalability problems, but latency can absolutely devastate performance. So your data modeling, whether you choose to model the data in a certain way or the database chooses it, it matters a lot. And that means some workloads will work better than others. And you should expect that some Postgres functionality is not available when you distribute your tables or use a distributed Postgres version. But I mean, these will all get better over time in all the implementations. So next steps, enjoy the live stream. I'll be on the hallway track all day on Discord in the next few days. And there's also some great on-demand talks, some on also like some of the scalability issues of Postgres I mentioned. If you want to start using Citus, I recommend checking our GitHub page, and there's also links to like the docs and other resources that can help you get started. All right, thanks very much.
That was wonderful, Marco.
Thank you, Marco. It was a great talk. I know a lot about Citus myself, but still I learned a few things.
great.
Well, that's good to know. I want to make sure you don't know everything yet, Yelta.
Well, I'd like him to know everything. But...
So we have a few questions. The first is, what's the most unexpected use case of Citus that you've seen over the years? And yeah, I stole that question from you, Yelta.
that's a nice question. So I think one of my favorites is the UK coronavirus dashboard. It was, apart from being like a very important public service, I think it was a great insight into the challenge of dealing with data, where it basically combines data from all these different sources at different granularities, different age, and different formats sometimes. And then it was a very small team, mostly led by Puria, who built this. And actually, a lot of the data integration just happens with like SQL queries that are parallelized using Citus, and then kind of rendered in the dashboard, and the results are cached in the dashboard. But I think that was great to see. And I'm still like, I sometimes think of the queries that Puria wrote, and that actually they just work beautifully in parallel, and they merge all of this, these different data sources. And in the end, it's something that everyone can go in and have a look at. And you know, especially when Corona was a bit more active, or maybe it will be again in the future, hopefully not, but it's, you know, it was also a massively important thing. So that was surprising to see, like, just the you know, the pains of dealing with data, or the challenges of dealing with data. But it was also, it was very nice to work with the team there.
Well, that particular use case, Poria, that particular customer, UK HSA, I got so lucky that I was invited to co-author a blog post with Poria. So we did this massive deep dive, and I learned a ton in working on that with him. And in fact, we'll drop that link in the Discord for anybody who's interested, because Poria went into great detail about everything. And the thing I liked about it too is that he really embraced open source in that whole project. So one of the reasons he chose Citus and Postgres as the underlying database is because it was open source. He open sourced all of his queries. He open sourced the whole software stack. Like, it's a very open solution.
Yeah,
and it was running on Azure too, I think, as a platform, because he didn't want to have to self-manage it.
Right.
Yalta, you have more questions.
Yes, I definitely had. So one is, you're mentioning like this network latency. It's a big part of the problem, basically. It's like it's sort of the core problem that everything else follows from. So wouldn't faster networks solve this problem in a sort of a completely different way?
Yes, it would. But within, like, let's say the hardware realities, that's actually a little bit challenging. So, I mean, in theory, cloud providers could give you this kind of gold plated, hey, here's your rack, and machines are right next to each other with these extremely fast network links between them. But then you quickly get the question of, like, well, what if I want to scale that out? What does my cloud provider do? Do they go and, like, move things around in the data center to just, like, put stuff next to each other? Again, essentially, it's like not a cloud model anymore.
Like physically carrying your racks around.
yeah, basically. And then, you know, what kind of downtime that occurs. Also, if I have, like, this special rack where all the machines are next to each other, like, what if that goes down? Like, how's the availability handled? So, let's say in a hypothetical timeline where cloud wasn't the main platform where we deploy our software, you'd probably end up with very different distributed database architectures. But I think even with features like placement groups and proximity placement groups, it's still not very economical, let's say, for the cloud to just, you know, you buy one machine, but it actually has to reserve the whole rack in case you want to scale out in the future with low latency. It's just not very practical. So that's a challenge. But definitely as hardware will evolve, and some of the cloud techniques will evolve, distributed databases will have to kind of evolve with it as well.
Okay. And then sort of the final question, I guess, is, you told a lot of things about what Citus does now, but what are you working on? That, like, what's the next big thing for Citus, pretty much?
Is that rhetorical? I mean, you know the answer, right, Yalta?
I mean, I'm always interested in finding out what Marco thinks.
Okay, I'm in that camp too. So yeah, let's go.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I also have these different arcs in mind of, like, how long do we have? But I think in the short-ish term, one of the things we're very much focused on is make things easier for software as a service application. So one of the things we're building is this schema level sharding, so that you don't have to specify a shard key, but every schema just goes into a different node, which makes it very easy to build these types of multi-tenant software service applications, because you don't have to specify a distribution key or anything like that.
Okay, that would be a big deal.
Yeah, I think so.
That sounds very interesting. Are there any downsides to doing that?
Yeah, I mean, you get more shards, let's say, more tables, which, I mean, doesn't have, I mean, it creates a downside on us that we then have to do more work to make Citus work well with a lot of tables. I think I mean, there's some practical things like, okay, well, as a user, then I have to manage things across schemas rather than in one set of tables, like if I want to add a column. So, but I mean, this is actually a very common pattern that people already do on just regular single node Postgres with various ORMs. So we think it will work pretty well. A longer term, I think we need to get like completely flesh out the Postgres compatibility of distributed tables so that just any query works and as efficiently as possible. Like this, there's like these, some of these really long arcs because we can make things faster and faster and faster. There's various other areas we can get into, but like we probably also have
move on
time.
To our next speaker, probably. Yes. Marco, big, big thank you for coming and giving this keynote today and being part of Citus Con and leading the project.
Yes, thanks a lot, Marco.
You're welcome, and thanks for having me.